Става въпрос за човек, който работи в големия хадронен колайдер в ЦЕРН. И ще ви разкаже как там има страшно много хардуер, виртуален и физически. И какви са предизвикателствата, когато част от този хардуер е много стар, много възрастен. Обаче трябва да работи и да продължава да работи. И зомбифициран пак да работи. И така, за сървърната геронтология. Между другото, колко от вас знаят какво е геронтология без да го проверяват в Google? Си вдигнат ръката. Добре, виждам гора от ръце, което е супер, защото сме на OpenFest. И хората са умни и си знаят, дори без Google. И така. Без повече ала-бала, на вашето внимание представям Христо Мохамед!
Okay, so they already said I'm Христо Мохамед. I will tell about how we manage some infrastructure in our data center and mainly how we are trying to save money more and more. So I work in the LHCb experiment. It's one of the four big experiments. We are a separate entity from the CERN IT. So with that, we are also a small team of system administrators. So we need to manage our resources very smart. We also don't have so much budget, so all the money count. Generally, I'm going to talk about gerontology. This is like the study of becoming old and of using and the process of using old things. So does anyone know what is this that you see on the photo? I will start with a little question that we're not going to answer now. Minus the servers, you see some racks that we're going to talk about. They're very special racks. Other than that, about me, I'm a system administrator there, obviously. And I'm mostly doing the configuration management. I'm mostly concerned with the puppet, with the monitoring of the infrastructure and so on. This is what my basic duties. And I also like to go around and present things that we do at LHCb. I'm doing the talk in English because I was already at another conference this year in Croatia. They had very interesting talks, but most of them were in Croatian, so I understood nothing. So we have to start with the introducing of the LHCb. LHCb is basically one of the four big detectors. We have a big circle with many different detectors. Each detector is like a huge camera or many big cameras which take, let's say, photos of the collisions that happen, and then various people do analysis on the photos. In the LHCb we have a few detectors. We have a calorimeter detector, a velo detector, different ridge detectors. It is basically one of the, it records decaying particles containing B and anti-B quarks. But I'm not a physicist person. In layman terms, it is trying to study why there is no symmetry between matter and antimatter in the universe. I'm not a physicist person, so I cannot really speak more about that, but I'm more about the computer part. So first we have to talk about old hardware. We need to ask ourselves a few questions. Are we really sure we want to use old hardware? First we have to determine if it's right for our organization. These are different organizational needs and that each organization must think about before trying to utilize their own hardware and not recycling it or reselling it to others. Second, we need to see what is our team's in energy. Is our team going to accept using very old hardware? Are people ready to invest their time in using the old hardware and to battle the problems that you have with using old hardware? So some initial considerations is that you must have enough space. If you just have two racks in your little data center, that is if you have a data center. How many here have an infrastructure that has a data center? Okay, quite a lot. And I guess the majority of other people use some kind of virtual private solution like Amazon or whatever. Yes. Anyway, so if you don't have enough space in your data center, you cannot really use old hardware. Why? Because it takes a lot of space. If you have just a few racks and you're struggling for space, then old hardware is not for you. You have a lot of spare parts. You have a lot of bad servers that you need to throw out. And this is not such an easy procedure. You have to recycle them. You cannot just take them and throw them in some trash somewhere or just throw them whatever. Second, no one has to hold you accountable for not having the latest hardware. Maybe your organization is certified with some other organization. Maybe you're trying to sell that certification so people give you more credo in the market. Then old hardware is not for you. If you're going to be using machines that are 5 or 6 or more years old, people are just not going to take your service. But then you have to be comfortable running against the clock. This is very important. Old hardware is old for a reason. Maybe it's out of support, completely out of support. Maybe it's going to break up a lot. You're basically running against the clock and trying to save money doing so. Your automatization team must really know what they're doing. By that I mean that change of one old server with another should take you no time at all. It should basically be you take out the old server, you put the new server, and everything should happen magically. So even your little child should be able to change the server. So this is the way you're going to be saving money, and it's all not really suitable for computing. By computing, I mean you're not going to be doing calculating prime numbers or doing big scientific calculations on the old hardware. This is going to be for your control infrastructure like DNS servers, DHCP servers, and so on. Before I get attacked here by some network administrator, someone that manages huge infrastructure, our 3,000 or so machines are managed by one 9-year-old DNS entry that is getting not loaded at all. So if you have a medium-sized data center, you can really do without hardware for this. Now a lot of people are concerned with electricity. I took the time yesterday to do some comparison. So we have some, I took Dell, why Dell? Because we have a lot of Dells at LHCb. So if you have 11th generation machine, so this was probably done in 2010, I think. It's going to give you, cost you 400 watts of electricity per power if it's loaded. Then you have the other machines, which basically cost a lot of money if you consider them. And since we are not using this for computation, we are going to be using this for control infrastructure. Our infrastructure is not going to be using a lot of electricity. It's not really paying to buy always the new toys when you can use the old ones and save money on it. Now, why do recycling and DUI? Well, it can be a lot of fun. You can do a lot of old things without hardware. And I'm not talking about setting up the proprietary, just setting up the lab that every data center has for the sysadmins to play around. You can do a lot more with that. You can set up different labs for different people. You can learn a lot of things which are not related to system administration. In one of the examples I will give later, I will show how even people learn how to 3D model for us to save more money. It allows you to be very creative. You can come up with various solutions that you wouldn't have thought about that before, just to save a lot more money. And yes, it's about money. Everything is about money. If everyone had the budget that you had, you could have bought all the new toys and all the new hardware and never be bothered with recycling at all. Now I'm going to give a few examples of things that we did, which I find interesting, and I hope you also find interesting. And the idea is to maybe inspire those of you who have some data center and work in a data center to maybe look around more for solutions that they can implement there and maybe save their organization some money. So first we had a lot of this M600 blades. Anyone here know what is a blade server? Okay, quite a lot of people. For that other, we don't know what is a blade. You have this huge chassis that weighs 50 kilos, and all the sysadmins are puffing and swearing when they try to put it in the rack, and then you can stack a lot of hardware inside. What is good about these blades is that they're very light. They're like, I don't know, let's say 5 kilos is a blade or 6 kilos, I don't know. They're not heavy at all. They're very easily replaceable inside of it. So at some point we had to change the infrastructure. We had over 300 of those blades, and we were asking ourselves what to do with the 300 blades. We had a lot of chassis for them. We had a lot of spares for them. You cannot imagine, we had a full room full of chassis, of power supplies, of NICs, of routers, everything that you can imagine for those blades. But they had a lot of, we wanted to boot all our servers over NFS, so we can utilize all the base for storage. And we started to look around what we could do. We could, of course, buy a new server or old server from eBay and do that for our NFS boot servers. But this would have to spend a lot of money to create redundancy. If we wanted to create some redundant NFS booting environment, we would have to buy a lot of machines, because NFS booting machines do fail. And once the main machine fails, that part of the cluster is down. And we looked at these blades. We had over 300, as I said, of them. They were manufactured in 2008. When we implemented the solution, it was 2014. So these blades were already 6 years old. They were out of warranty, but they were still working pretty well. They had ECC RAM. Now I say ECC RAM because I'll talk about ZFS a bit later. Now there are probably here people who did some ZFS, I think. I'm looking at here, yes. Maybe they want to argue if you need ECC RAM, but this is argument for outside. And they also had a gigabit interface, which was important when we really overload that part of the cluster. They had 2 drive bays, which already screams ZFS over a RAID 1. And the most important part is that FreeNAS worked out of the box. Why FreeNAS? Well, it's very cool. It's free to use it. And we want to use open source solutions. It is not so hard to configure it. On a mass scale like ours, we had over 100 FreeNAS boxes running all the time. Minus the redundancies, so let's make it even more than 100. It took some manpower in order to configure the FreeNAS, but generally it was easily configurable. And at the time, there was no other ZFS solution. We could have used ZOL, that is ZFS on Linux, but 2 years ago, I'm not going to argue if it was stable in production or not. But we did not want to be the vanguard of ZFS on Linux. We had a 2,000 plus machines cluster that had to be available all the time. We couldn't accept more than a few percent of the cluster to be down. We needed a solution that was very easy for the technicians to change, and FreeNAS was our solution. even if one of the blades, the two redundant blades failed, we would just lose 1.5% of the cluster, so that was not a big. And being easy replaceable, every technician can change it very fast. So this created our perfect NFS boot server. These servers had been used over 2 years, and they were very nice. I mean, if something breaks down, it was as easy as the technician or whatever. I mean, it could be even have a, we have a physicist on shift every night that monitor the physics data. If the ZFS first server fell down, they didn't need to call the sysadmin who had to do this or that, make the, that part of the cluster boot from another blade. If the tour didn't see failed, the guy just had to go to the data center, take a blade, put another blade in, put the USB stick, and the magic would happen. This solution worked very good for us. We had so much time with very little downtime on our cluster, but unfortunately ZFS 9.3 happened at some point. FreeNAS 9.3 happened at some point, which introduced ZFS as rootFS. Now I don't know if anyone here tried to do ZFS on a USB stick, but it just doesn't work. On the mailing list there is a very nice sentence I like: ZFS kills cheap USB, and this is really true. So from a very cheap solution, because we already had the blades, we had the spares, so if a blade breaks, we just put it in a bad pile, and we put another one from the good pile, we get to regularly, everyday change over 5 or 6 USB sticks. So you can imagine that the 10 euro USB stick that we used, the cheapest of course, you have to change every day, it's like 50 euro, that's like 1,000 euro or more per month just for changing USB sticks. At the time, we were really ready to throw the M16 away because they had no other slots. These were 8-year-old machines. You could not talk about SATA DOM or whatever new technology there is on the market. So we were really on the verge of throwing them out or rolling back to FreeNAS 8-point-something. For those of here who used FreeNAS, they know that before version 9-point-something, it was really a spam. I mean, it was spamming you all the time with emails. Yes, everything is all right. Everything is all right. Everything is all right. We didn't want to read all the emails. We didn't want to script around and hack around things. We want to adhere to the FreeNAS philosophy of not touching the rootFS so much. So we really wanted to use 9.3. Plus, it brought a lot of nice things, updating it. There is now version 10-something, just for information. And we had to think of a solution. Now, looking at the slots of the M16, there were no other slots except USB and the 2-drive bays. We didn't want to sacrifice the right one, because that we have to sacrifice part of the rootFS of the clusters. So we had to think of another solution, which came in the form of this. Now, can anyone see what's this abomination that they see here? Yes, we used USB. So now we used zip ties, like the ones in the news. And this here is the chassis. This is one blade. And here you have the zip tie, or svinsko paška. Basically what this guy is, this is a very cheap converter from M-SATA to USB. This goes inside. We bought the cheapest SSDs on the market, 8 gigabit or 16 gigabit, I don't know. The entire solution for over 100 nodes costed less than 1,000 euro. We even have some spares. And then we just attach them in and we zip tie them here. And this runs on over 10 of these chassis everywhere. So this is around 100 something servers that look like this. Now there are problems with people sometimes tripping over it. We had that problem. So we had to put warning signs, please do not trip, or please look at the rack where we're walking. We had technicians destroy part of it, but it is working. We have lost, I think so far, a few SSDs, but as I said, this was ultra cheap SSDs, so it's normal for some of them to fail. They are booting very nice, everything is running pretty nice, and we had no problem in our 8 months of running like this, except someone tripping over it and destroying it. We were a bit concerned with the heating, because here you can see there is this fan and like this opening for electricity, but this really didn't happen. I mean, this is not a computational server, it's not overheating. Everything was perfect after a week of testing, so we decided to implement this solution. This solution cost us a lot. The solution saved us a lot and a lot of money, and it's working pretty nice. Another example I like to give is this guy. It's the Dell 1915. So we had a lot of these servers back in the past, just for various things. This was in production since May 2008, and the server was released in 2006, so this is already 10 years old. And it's working pretty well. All of our DNS infrastructure is running on this type of servers, or there is one even older, but let's not go there. All of our DHCP infrastructure is running on this. We have in-house monitoring solutions we use for various parts of the collider that run on this. Now this guy is very nice. I mean, to mount it, it's a bit hard, but after some tinkering, you get to it. And we use it for all infrastructure that we cannot virtualize for whatever reasons. Now we had some problem with this guy, and mainly it was this thing here. Now this is a capacitor that we had, which started to burn. But of course, people started then thinking, if people buy things from eBay, and there are plenty of people around ready to fix your electronics, we had 60 or so of these guys needed to be changed on servers, and we were really annoyed with this error, integrated write controller, PCI error. What could we do to fix it? We had plenty of suitable network interfaces left for these machines. We had plenty of PSUs. I mean, I can even give you PSUs if you want for these guys. And then we found some company that did all the repairs for 500 euro. We just had to ship them the little integrated write controllers. They changed everything, and this really saved us a lot of money. We didn't have to throw them out, because also recycling costs money. Reselling also costs money, and it takes manpower to do so. And here you can see when we bought them, they were still in warranty a long time ago. At the time, I don't think I was still in high school, I think. So at this time, they costed 28 cents to run per hour. And now, over the time, we have dropped to 11 euro cents per hour to run. So these are really cheap. These are running really well. As I say, enterprise-grade hardware, but it's running really well so far. All this that I've sent cost us, I don't know, cost one person one afternoon just to look for a company that will repair them. And it cost him one more hour to take all the little guys and then to put them in a nice box, to package it and to send it over. So overall, this solution cost us one day of manpower that one person had to be paid, and we did not have to buy anything else for it. We just had to ship them and put them back in. If one of these guys fails, he directly goes into the trash pile. Nobody ever bothers to repair any of those. We have so many of them. If we have so many spares for them that if somebody finds the free time or it's his hobby to try to repair something, he can do it. So this solution, the solution with M16s, costed us less than 6 days to implement. So this is 6 days with two people doing it. So this is how many work hours, 40, 48, 96 work hours that you have to pay instead of buying all the new hardware. So you can already see that a little bit of ingenuity, you can save a lot of money in your hardware center, in your data center. Now another example I want to give. Again, I ask, what is this rack here? Okay, I guess most people here, okay, raise your hand if you think this is a server rack. Okay. A server rack, maybe? No, just this, the racks. I mean, they are all the same rack. Nobody here thinks this is a server rack? No? So this is very old electronics rack. Very old electronics rack. So these guys were used in the Delphi experiment. So Delphi experiment probably started running before I was even going to school. But this is when these racks were made and taken. So these racks were really nice, they were really big, they are 60U per one rack. 60U means you can put 61 new servers. So for example, those 1950s, this guy is 1U, so you can put 60 of those in one rack. We had a lot of them, a lot. All of our data center is running on these racks, except one room. And they were already there. We had all the rails you want in the world for them. We had these little things here to put so it doesn't look ultra ugly. So they were basically there. But again, we had a problem with them. Either we had to throw them out, or we had to buy new racks. Now, before this lecture started, I checked on the internet, and I just wrote rack price, server rack price. I found some 16U rack that costed 1,400 euro. Now, here, I don't know how much a real rack cost. I've never bought a rack. But I guess this would have saved us a lot of money. But the problem is, we cannot put a server inside. The rack is fat in the inside, but it's too narrow the front. It is not too narrow by a lot, it's just by a little margin, maybe a centimeter too narrow. So this created a big problem. Did we have to throw the racks, still use them? How are we going to use them? Now we chose a bit of a, people were thinking, can I somehow enlarge the rack, like the Hulk maybe? And this is what we did. So this guy here, we call the rack extender. So this is really something out of a sci-fi novella. So this guy here is nothing more but two pieces of metal together, a spring and a hydraulic pump, a press. This is it. It was assembled, I think in a day, by a guy who did it just to try, one of the mechanics and engineers. And you can see here, you have to pump this handle and it starts to move. and it extends the metal. Does it damage it? Sure. But they were already for free, so. Now you can see here my bold colleague trying to extend the rack and battling with it because it's like 10 PSI, so it takes a bit of a pumping there. But it's nice also some gym for the sysadmins, except caring servers. And this is how it basically works. So you see here, this server is a bit too fat. It cannot fit in. You just put the rack extender. You pump it a bit. It extends the rack just enough. And then the server gets in. And everyone is happy. The server is in. It's not very abused. No servers were harmed here, except maybe one that I think I dropped once. And to remove it is very easy too. You just have to rotate a little valve, and it will drop out. And this solution, it just works. It doesn't take a lot of people. Basically, these guys weigh, these quads weigh around 40 kilos. So either you need somebody who is very strong, or you need two people to put it. The rack extender can be operated by one person as well. So your normal server putting crew of two can operate the rack extender and put the server at the same time. This guy here is so good that it actually extends the upper and the down parts too. So you have to do it only once. Does it damage the metal? Sure, it does. These racks were meant to be used. They were way out of warranty time. They're way out of usage time, but they're still in production. They're working. They have great ventilation. Everything works very well. The cooling is very well. It doesn't cost a lot of money. The power is there. Everything just works very nice. Another example, we like to 3D print rails. So we had a certain vendor, which I cannot discuss which one is it, because you might get sued. We wanted to use our hard drives, our own hard drives that we already had. We had plenty of hard drives, but the storage vendor did want to sell us the rails for a normal price. They wanted an arm and a leg. I don't remember how much, but it was the price of a hard drive would be the price of two rails. So we were thinking, okay, we either have to buy them or throw this storage solution in the trash. What would we do now? We also, at the time, we had a colleague who was very into 3D modeling. He was only talking about it, not doing it so much. And we also had a 3D printer bought for another purpose. So then somebody took the rail, that guy, and he took one day to create this. Now, this guy is a 3D printed rail for the storage vendor. We had some concerns that this rail is going to fail once we put it in the solution after the hard drive spins a bit, but this did not happen in 1 week. So we started to start printing more rails. Now, how much do you think this rail costs, production costs of this guy? $3. $3. Come on. It's much cheaper. 7 cents? Yes, this guy here is 20 cents. This is the price of the plastic. And this guy here takes it takes 30 minutes to print one. But we put them in a big batches, so they come out. For a day, you can print a lot of these guys. We just took 1 week, we put the printer, somebody wrote a script just to automatize, and one guy went from time to time to take the rails that were already printed, and we had a big box of rails. Now, the fun part here is that this way we engaged even more people, because people were very interested, even non-sysadmin crew, to see what the fuck are we doing. So they came to check what is happening. So we actually had people coming to help us screw the rails on the hard drives and to put them in the solution. So this took more people to engage them in the work. This also saved us quite a lot of money. Another thing, when I'm at my last example now, so how many here played video games in the past? Okay, everyone here, obviously. But how many played it like 10 years ago? Okay, a lot of people again. Does anyone know where is this from? Now this is from this. Okay, so I guess a lot of people know about Skyrim. Yes. Huh? Oblivion, Skyrim. No, this is from even older game. So this was called Morrowind in the past. So in the past, there was no fast travel between the towns, like now in Skyrim or in Oblivion. We had to run like an idiot. And there was a guy selling a taxi who said, why walk when you can ride? So at some point, we put a very nice virtualization infrastructure that we replaced. But this infrastructure had to be backed up. So okay, backing up on a tape, everyone knows here it's very slow. You need to buy a robot. You need to buy the tapes, which costs money. You need to store somewhere the tapes. And this all costs money. And why spend money when you can use something else? At the time, when we were wondering why should we walk when we can ride, we also had to change our storage solution and bought the new version. So the old version was left for us, and we had to throw it out. So I take the time to check. This is some Oracle Storage Tech tape, which is doing 252 megabytes per hour. This is supposed to be from the vendor side. I don't know if it's true. Has anyone used this I don't know. And at the same time, we check this diagram. It can be one of the two. But okay, we decided we had very good automation at the time. Our entire virtualization infrastructure could be regenerated very fast if somebody was to rebuild the VMs. And we also failure if it failed. Somebody had to set fire to the data center. So we really needed to, but we still wanted to do some backups. Our old server solution supported over 500 megabytes per hour to copy on it, the snapshot, and we decided to go with that. The good part was that this was already installed, it was already in a rack. We just had to move it a bit to the other rack. It was already configured, and it was interfacing with our new solution. So this is how we do our backups. We broke the tower of backup many times. We don't keep external backup somewhere, but since we can already regenerate everything ultra fast, we don't even need to. Our host solution is also redundant, and we are easily backing up the snapshot in a matter of, I don't know, minutes, hours. I've never done it myself, so I cannot say. But this also saved us a lot of money. So what I want to say with these examples was that before throwing something out, you should really check if you can use it somewhere and implement it for some other use. Now, to sum things up a bit, you really have to find the right balance between using the old hardware and or buying new things. Because manpower also costs money. So if you are, whenever you are, manpower costs money. It can cost a lot of money. 1 week of work time for somebody could be half a new server, for example. So you have to find also, you have to benchmark if the services you're using can be put on old hardware. For example, for control services, even some monitoring solutions, we personally have an Ichinga, one server, that is monitoring, reactively monitoring our infrastructure, that is running on the, I think, one newer generation than the M600 blades, and it's really not loaded at all. So this is a service that we benchmark correctly, and we could put on old hardware. So you really have to benchmark your services if you can put them on old hardware. And also, you have to really create redundancy for these guys, because a lot of them fail all the time, and your DevOps or sysadmin or whatever team you like to call it really needs to know his job, so you don't have big downtimes from time to time. And now I am ready to welcome your questions.
Вопросы? Така, супер.
In your environment, you have a lot of bespoke equipment that's being used for monitoring experiments.
Yes.
Which are built by some scientists 20, 30 years ago. Have you had any experience with taking those and virtualizing them so that they can continue to work in their format they are?
Yes. So basically, this does not happen. Why? Because it's too expensive to do so. I mean, you have some old something that's written a long time ago. It was never, at the time it was written, it was not meant to, they didn't even know what is a virtual machine at the time. So just to port it to a newer solution requires a lot of hours. So these hours you have to pay somebody to do it, and it's cheaper just to keep it on old legacy hardware than to port them. I guess in the future when somebody rewrites the tool, because constantly at CERN things are getting rewritten to a newer technology, but old things continue to be used until they're replaced. In the future, when someone replaces a certain tool, we put it on a virtual machine, let's say. We still don't use containers because we don't like them. When we put it on a virtual machine and we retire the old server and it goes in the good pile if it's still working.
Okay, so there's this slide, a couple slides back that talked about bandwidth, and I didn't quite understand with this 252 megabytes figure. Could you repeat that, please?
Okay, so I was saying that it was useless for us to buy a tape solution to put the snapshots to our virtualization, because tapes are generally expensive per se, and the tape that I found on the internet with the most copy speed was this one. It's some Oracle something tape that costed $130, this tape. And you needed also a specific robot to run it. So that's why we decided to use our old vendor appliance for storage, and which was interfacing with the newer appliance that was having our virtualization infrastructure, because it could support easily 400 megabytes. It was two interfaces, 200 megabytes each, to copy the snapshots there and back them up there.
Okay, so it was tapes. I missed that. Thank you.
Hi. I'm not a sysadmin, but you mentioned earlier about clustering. Can you tell us one or two sentences about the type of clustering with old machines, namely if it can be seen as a big server or other types?
For the clustering with the old machines that we do?
Yes.
Okay, so for the clustering with old machines, so for example, our NFS, the older servers, so we have a certain script that is making them a bit redundant. This is like ingrown home solution. If you buy through NAS, for example, you can do this with the appliance itself, but we have our own solution that we do. We have other, for example, we have our DNS cluster. We're learning like highly available DNS, highly available DHCP, and so on. And for other appliances, which I'm not concerned of, there are other clusters which I cannot talk about.
Thank you.
But yes, we have had a lot of DNS servers dying, and then somebody had to replace them. But yeah.
I probably missed that part, but talking about virtualization, what do you use to virtualize your environment?
We're using KVM. We are paying the mothership Red Hat money, and we use KVM.
I really appreciate your knowledge, and I'm doing something quite similar to your experience, and I'm very interested. Do you share your experience somewhere? I mean, except this presentation, do you tend to do some talk about low-cost computing or something? Or
yes, we are. Well, basically, if anyone asks, we, at least in LHCb, we are, okay, at CERN as well, we are very much embracing open source technologies, and we are trying to contribute to the community. So if you have any question, you can ask. For example, you can send me an email, and I will answer it immediately. We are trying to give as much back to the community, because the majority of our infrastructure runs on open source hardware, on personal software, sorry, not hardware. So we try to contribute to the community.
Are you using some of the old servers for gaming with some
gaming?
Upgrades?
No, we don't. There is a strict policy that you cannot do this at CERN. But I don't think they would be very good gaming machines anyway, for various reasons. So,
by the way, I have a question as well. Have you tried using, I've seen clusters made of old gaming hardware, for example, the GPUs of the first generation Xbox and PlayStations. Have you considered making such clusters?
No, because our software is very highly specialized to the x86 infrastructure, I mean the computing software. And I think there is some initiative to port it to PowerPC for some tests, because now we're considering making completely new data center and buying new things now, and maybe trying to reuse some of our old machines. But there is initiative to port it to PowerPC, but otherwise we're very much we're very much married with x86.
Okay,
and it's also a lot of computing infrastructure that if you have to port it for CUDA or to whatever, it will take a lot of time.
So have you thought about any strategy or tactics about how to have an interface between the new stuff that you're going to buy and the old one that is already working for you?
Well, generally, old hardware we use to control the new hardware. So basically, we have a lot of control machines because we have many processes which have some side of APIs to open, to be controlled. So we have many processes which need to be controlled by the people who are not sysadmins or not in the IT staff. So these are people who are physicists or different scientists. So they create different panels for themselves or write different scripts. So people open different APIs. And we have a lot of processes running just on these control machines, which are then contacting our processing farm, which is the new machines, for example. These guys here. So this O is just doing computation and then stores the useless data, throws the useful data, throws away the useless data, and we have plenty of those who we use to control different things. So basically, when a scientist wants to control different process, he can just contact one of those guys and maybe break up this one and not break up the computational cluster.
Other questions? Andre Frage? Други въпроси? Well then, let's give a big shout out and a round of applause.